Hello friends, today we will be discussing about the various characteristics of groups. Groups are very distinct from individuals. So there are certain defining characteristics that set groups apart from a single person. How a person behaves when he is alone versus how a person behaves when he is part of a group. How a group behaves as compared to an individual. If you look at that, there are distinct differences, and these form the features or the characteristics of what we call groups. Some of the basic characteristics of groups are status, roles, norms, size, composition, and cohesiveness. Today, we will be looking at each of these in detail, one by one. Let us start with the concept of status. What is status? Status refers to an individual's position or rank within a group. Where does an individual fit into that set of individuals which forms a group? In a group, not all people have equal status. What contributes to the difference that we see as being someone as being higher status, someone as having a lower status in a group? On what basis does this happen? It could happen because of several reasons. One could be, in the case of a formal group, the status is accorded in the way the group is structured. Status comes with a variety of factors. For example, someone has been with the group for a longer period of time. Then what happens? Obviously, he or she would know more about how things are done than someone who has joined recently. Similarly, let us take the case of someone who is probably far more aged, that is a senior by age. In that case also, because of his experience with the group or similar groups, that person would probably have a higher status in the group. Physical attributes, studies have found, also contribute to status or the perceived status of individuals in a group. And what studies have found is someone who has more favorable physical attributes, a taller looking person, a more good looking person, basically, at an instinctive level, such people are accorded a higher status. A factor like height can accord a person a higher status. This is what studies have found. And this is not always done consciously, but it happens because of human nature, which tends to distinguish between people and tends to accord different status to different people within the same set of individuals who form a particular group. Suppose you ask a teacher, who do you think is a good student? Now, what would the teacher say? The teacher would say, a good student is the one who has interest in his subjects. A good student is one who is disciplined. A good student is one who is hardworking. A good student is one who is regular to his classes. A good student is one who does his work on time, who takes responsibility for his actions within the college or within the school. Now, this is the kind of image a person carries in his mind or her mind when they are talking about a good student. Now, what happens when a teacher enters into a class of 40, 50, 60 students and there is one or there are a few people who match this kind of image that we have? So automatically, these people become representative of what a good student means to the teacher. So a representative or a prototype of a good student, unconsciously, in such cases, sometimes consciously, sometimes unconsciously, such students or such people are given a higher status. Within the class, all students are equal, but a person who is representative of the group is accorded a higher status. What's interesting is, it's not just the other members according him a higher status. It is also found that people who are having a higher status in a group behave differently compared to the rest of the group members. When group members have a lower status within the group, what happens? They have a strong desire to be seen as part of the group. So, people with higher status are found to behave in ways which are different from those in a lower status. Moving on to the next characteristic of a group, this is what are called norms. What did we say are norms? Norms are rules and expectations. Norms are the acceptable standards of behavior within a group, and these are shared by group's members, and it is accepted by all the group members. Sometimes these are clearly spelt out, sometimes they are not spelt out but understood. An important norm which differentiates people's behaviors in groups is whether the group has collectivistic norms or individualistic norms. Collectivism versus individualism. What do we mean when we say collectivism, and what is individualism? Collectivism is a norm which says you have to maintain harmony among group members, if necessary, at the cost of personal beliefs. That is, group consensus or agreement within the group, harmony within the group, seeing eye to eye within the group, sharing common beliefs within the group is more important than what you as an individual think or what you as an individual believe in, your individual beliefs are. So, at a personal cost, the collectivism norm is maintained in groups. To cite some examples, when we are looking at say the work culture in most of the Japanese companies, in such companies, working as a group, agreeing to the seniors, doing what is expected of you, not giving suggestions until and unless you are asked, are all part of the collectivistic norms in a Japanese work culture. So, in such cases, even if the individual has personal beliefs or even if the individual thinks differently, he or she will not go against the collectivistic norms. Again, as I said, personally, you may believe in doing things in a particular manner. You may follow a particular religion, but if an organization has a set collectivistic norm of being a-religious within work settings, then you keep your personal values, personal beliefs to yourself, and when you are at your workplace, you do not show or exhibit any visible signs of your personal choices. But then there are also other groups where individualistic norms are followed. Groups which encourage individualistic norms are groups where people are allowed to be different. People are allowed to stand out from the group. Disagreements between members are tolerated. Let's say we are discussing about how to do a particular problem. A group of friends sitting together trying to solve a problem. trying to solve a mathematics problem, for which the answer doesn't seem to be very easy or very evident. Now, what kind of a group is this? This is an informal group. This is a group where there is a high degree of bonding. This is a group where there is a high level of interdependence and interaction between the group members. And this is also a group where individualism is tolerated, where an individualist norm is followed. So, in such cases, each one can suggest one way of doing things. It may be right, it may be wrong, but you are not stopped from expressing what you think, what you feel. It may be debated, it may be discussed, it may be followed, it may not be followed, it may be rejected. But there is no disagreement as far as expression is concerned. Now, what happens when group norms are violated again depends on several things, on several factors. One, as we said, whether the norm is collectivist or individualist, and two, how far do you identify with the group? Now, this is another new aspect. How far do you identify with the group as a group member? Let's take the example of a classroom. Let's take the example of two students. One student who is highly motivated, highly focused, very interested in the subject. And another student who is there because he wants to do his graduation, but who is not very keen on that particular subject. At the same time, he knows that he has to be part of the classes, he has to clear that paper also successfully for completing his graduation successfully. This is a typical classroom situation and two students in the same classroom. Now, the first person, and what is the group in this case? The group is the class. So, who are the group members? The group members are all the students in the class and the teacher who is taking the class. What is a group norm generally when a class is taking place? The teacher or the lecturer delivers the lecture and the students listen, take notes, ask relevant questions which help in understanding what is being told and generally avoid all those behaviors which disrupt the class. Now, let us suppose there is a third student who is engaging in some disruptive behavior. Probably asking irrelevant questions or probably talking constantly, creating a noise in the class, sitting in the last bench, moving around, sitting in the front bench, shuffling and distracting the class. Or there could be someone who has a mobile switched on and so keeps getting calls. So, the mobile rings and it disrupts the flow of the class. So, here are a set of actions which are generally considered to be against the norms of or violating the norms of the classroom etiquette, the group called class. Now, what possible reactions could be there? One, for someone who is highly identifying with the group, that is the person who is highly involved, highly motivated, interested in the class, there could be several reactions. He or she may, after class, tell the person not to engage in such behaviors, or they may directly talk to the teacher and tell them not to encourage or request them, or the teacher himself or herself being very motivated, being identifying with the group, may tell the student this is not acceptable. Okay, so the case of an involved student and the case of a involved teacher. What about the person who is there in the class listening to the class because it is required but is not totally identifying with the group? What do you think he or she would do? they won't really bother much, isn't it? So in the case of a person who doesn't identify himself with the group, irrespective of whether the norm is collective or individualist, when the group norm is violated, there is not much of an influence, there is not much of an opinion, but a negative evaluation happens when there is high degree of identification with the group and when there is a collective norm. That is, in this case, the negative evaluation is in terms of either challenging the person openly, warning him, or in the case of a teacher telling him to go out of the class, the dissent is shown. The disagreement is not tolerated. When the norm is violated, the action is not tolerated. So this is the cost of violating group norms. The other possibility is a case of an individualist norm being encouraged in a particular group. In such cases, what happens? When the group norms are violated, it is accepted. Why? Because the very norm of the group is tolerating disagreements. So in such cases, the cost of violating group norms is not very high. Now we move on to a third characteristic, that is roles within the groups. Now roles are with respect to individuals. How am I supposed to behave as a member of this group? As a student, what is expected out of you? As a teacher, what is expected out of me? So I, when I am a teacher, have a particular role to fulfill. You as a student have a particular role to fulfill. Outside the classroom, when you are with a bunch of friends, your role is totally different. You are there playing a role of a friend, a mate. So in such cases, you play a different role. When you go home, you play the role of a brother, of a son, of a sister. Again, same person, different role in a different group. So role is a set of expected behavior patterns attributed to someone occupying a given position in a group. If you take a formal group like a work environment, within the confines of the office from 9 to 5, which are the work timings, the supervisor behaves in a particular manner. Because the office decorum requires it, he might maintain a certain distance. But let us suppose you invite him over for some function at your house. Would he behave in the same manner? No, he would behave in a different way. So in the office environment, he is playing the role of a superior. So the relationship of a superior subordinate is maintained and you play the role of a subordinate. When he comes to your house, he plays the role of a guest and you play the role of a host. So in such cases, again, what is expected of the, out of the role is totally different. So we are now having another new term here, that is role perception. An individual's view of how he or she has to act in a given situation. As a subordinate, you behave in a particular manner. So your perception of the role of a subordinate in an office means that you arrive on time, you take your superior's permission to move out of the office campus, you discuss things with your superior, you share things in a meeting, you present the required information. So all this is part of what you believe you are supposed to do in a particular situation. That becomes role perception. Similarly, as a superior, he will ask you questions, He will ask you for information. He will call you for discussions, appreciate you sometimes, probably warn you that you are not doing things the right way sometimes. Again, it is because he perceives his role as a superior in a certain manner. So, this is the concept of role perception. The other side of it is what is called role expectations. You believe as a student, this is what I have to do. You also believe as a teacher, this is what he or she is expected to do. So, your expectation of what another person has to do, how he has to behave, how he has to act, how he or she has to carry himself, how he or she has to respond. Now, this is what is called role expectation. When you see a lady in the role of a mother, in the role of your mother, you expect her to be tolerant, you expect her to serve you, you expect her to fulfill your needs, take care of your wants, you expect her to do a lot of things for you. But when she goes out and is in part of a work environment, when she goes out as a teacher in a particular school, what are your role expectations? As a teacher, you expect her to go to classes, teach students, correct notebooks, help children, maintain timings, submit marks. These are your expectations of the person when he or she is fulfilling a different role of the same person. A third concept is role identity. That is, all these things put together that define a role. When we say a hero in a movie, what is the role identity? Role identity is generally, when we say hero, we expect some heroic deeds, we expect action, we expect initiative, we expect sacrifice, we expect selflessness. So, hero in a movie, hero in a real life situation contains a particular identity. And when you become a leader in a class, when you become a leader or when you are expected to lead in any particular situation, there is a particular role identity. Now, these attitudes, these behaviors which are consistent with the role is what is called role identity. Now, all these things do not happen suddenly. When a person becomes part of an organization, let's say, he or she learns how to behave in ways which are consistent with the organization's expectations. It takes a little time. And after that, a person internalizes it and it becomes part of yourself. So, social roles get internalized and they become part of ourselves. We consider ourselves, I think I am a good friend. So, whenever my friend wants something, I am willing to do it for him, irrespective of the time, irrespective of whether it is convenient or not, because it is part of my identity as a friend. Similarly, as a student, I go to college. As a fun-loving person, I bunk classes, whether it is required or not. As a part of my identity as a fun-loving person, I want to go and watch movies. As a part of my identity as a daredevil, I want to have a bike. So, you see, once our own perception gets internalized, our identity becomes a part of self. The role identity becomes part of an individual.
Do persons really behave differently in different roles?
Yes. In fact, we have classic studies to show how people differently behave in different roles. Zimbardo's experiment, what is called the Stanford Prison Experiment, is a very classic study. What happened was, Zimbardo asked for a few volunteers And he randomly assigned them to two groups. One group was called prisoners, and another group was called the guards or the policemen. And this study was supposed to take place over a period of 2 weeks, that is 15 days. Now, these people were told that you are all inmates of a prison. This group is guards who are going to be symbols of authority, symbols of power. And the other group is the group of prisoners who are lodged in the prison. But just 6 days into the study, and the study was terminated. Do you know why? The people who were acting as guards started behaving very authoritatively. The minute they got into the role of guards, they started harassing, they started behaving in ways which tried to control, dominate over the other group, which is the group of prisoners. And what do you think happened with these people who were playing the role of prisoners? These people actually started feeling depressed, started feeling lost, started feeling that they have no control on their lives. And a classic real life situation was replicated with volunteers who knew that this was just a mock. Now imagine if a mock situation, an experiment, can reach a stage where people start becoming very aggressive, abusive, just because they are playing the role of a prison guard. In real life, when people are having power, when people are at a seat of authority and the role they play is giving them that kind of a situation, putting them in that kind of a situation, obviously, the behaviors they exhibit will be totally different. Recently, BBC again did a similar study. But in this case, what happened? People were not randomly assigned. People were told that a lot of tests will be conducted. Psychological tests were conducted. And they decided that these people fit the role of a guard and these people fit the role of prisoners. And just a few days into the experiment, what they said was, actually, there are no differences in the people who are playing the role of guards and the people who are playing the role of prisoners. Plus, they were also told that some prisoners could be elevated and made guards. Now, with this kind of additional information, what happened was the earlier behaviors were not exhibited. People who were behaving like guards were reminded that they were volunteers and that the study is not really making any difference, that their behaviors are not really very different. When this information was shared, what happened was the people who were playing the role of guards did not show as much aggression or authority as the participants in the original experiment showed. On the contrary, the people who were playing prisoners became very aggressive, became very dominating. So the results were totally different. Why? Because the role perception was different in the first experiment and in the second experiment. So yes, definitely how people behave in groups would depend on the role they play, the norms in the group, and the role perception and role expectations.